Thank you so much for joining us on this rainy day. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Brett Davidson. I lead the Alumni Relations and Development team here at the Perelman School of Medicine. And before we begin and I introduce Dr. Gail Morrison, I wanted to give you a couple updates. One is the parade and picnic will be here today. We're doing it indoors. We will do our best to make it feel like you're outside having a good time. That leads me to, I wanted to thank our team in Alumni Relations and Development for putting on this weekend for you all. We hope that you learn a lot, have fun with your former classmates, and enjoy Penn and Philadelphia. So without further ado, I'm really privileged to be able to introduce Dr. Gail Morrison. For those who you don't know, Dr. Gail, she's the William Measey Presidential Distinguished Professor of Medical Education. She serves as our Senior Vice Dean for Education and directs the academic programs here at the Perelman School of Medicine. For over 30 years, she's been directing our educational programs here, whether it be by department or the entire school. She created in 1997 a revolutionary curriculum for the institution, has become the envy of all of our peer institutions around the country. And she's done an unbelievable job with our students, faculty, and administration in getting us to one of the top medical programs in the country for, I think, 19, 20, 21 straight years, and we're very proud of that. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Gail Morrison.
I'm excited that you're all here with us today, both because it's alumni weekend, but also because we can give you a little idea of what it's like to be a medical student in the 21st century, which I think all of you will say, oh my goodness, that wasn't the way I learned when I was here, and I was here with you also in the late 1970s, 80s, et cetera. We thank the students for being here with us because we know it's Saturday morning. This is not usually when they like to get up early and be with us, so I thank you all for being with us. You know, all of this gets done because we have a fabulous School of Medicine with a fabulous group of faculty, a fabulous leadership from the dean all the way down that supports education top-notch to make sure that we're always at the top of our game. But without great leadership, great faculty, great students, you know, our wonderful new building, it wouldn't happen. And so it really is, when it says it takes a village to do things, this takes a city, this takes a country to make sure that we come out with this. But this was everybody working together to try to make the education for the 21st century be something that we're all committed to together. So let me just take you through a very quick run through of where we were and where we are. And then you're going to see where we're going is really you're going to see what people are doing today. So when we came through medical school, the Flexner years, 1910 and beyond, the concept was that medical schools would be 2 years of basic science and then 2 years of clinical work. And the concept was that most of that clinical work would occur in a hospital setting for acute, and you took care of acute illness, sent them home, and that was it. And that became the model that was for the last 80, 90 years up through about 2000, the model for most medical schools, give or take a few months here or there within each of those years. That meant you did normal science the first year. You then follow that with abnormal, which we call pathophysiology, pathology, et cetera, the second year. Penn started their clerkships a little bit earlier in the second year. You then did regular clerkships and then electives in any kind of order that you wanted to do it. And then you graduated, didn't stay longer, most likely, than 4 years, unless you were getting a PhD, and then moved on to your internship and residency. All right. We were asked by Bill Kelly in 1995, when he appointed me to become the vice dean for the school, I want you to put together people to decide what is the curriculum for the 21st century. And that made us all bring people together to sit back to really say, what does the future look like, when we really weren't quite sure. because when you look into this ball, this glass ball for the future, it's pretty fuzzy for what the future, and it's still pretty fuzzy for what the future for medicine is going to look like. But here's some of the things that we did come up with. First of all, why do we do principles of basic science and then clinical work separate? So we said medical education had to be this continuum. We should be teaching this together so they understand why they're learning the principles of basic science. Therefore, it had to be an integration of basic science and clinical medicine, not just in certain times, but throughout the whole four-year curriculum. And gee, everybody doesn't come out becoming the same kind of a doctor. Maybe we need to have a little more flexibility to allow people to do a little more things that they want to do, depending on what they want to go into. And man, are things changing more quickly. We better make it a little more self-directed, because it's no longer can you memorize everything, leave medical school, and think I never have to pick up a book or look at an article again. So this became our model that we took out to the faculty, that it was a continuum of science and medicine, heavy in the beginning, but it had to continue through the 4 years. We had to do technology and practice, which was clinical medicine, less in the first year, but then got heavier as you went through medical school. And we put in this new four-year curriculum in what we call professionalism and humanism, which was maybe you need to learn how to actually deal with people as a doctor, and patients, and how to talk to them. Because although we would see wonderful physicians that we would say, oh, I'm going to do that the next time I see a patient, that was really good, there really is a curriculum in this that tells you how to deal with people. And particularly, we all know, sick people, though they're very nice people, they're not very nice when they're sick. They're upset, they're angry, all these different things, and therefore you have to really teach them how to be capable of dealing with people who are in a struggling period of time. This then became the new model that we took out to the faculty. It is not courses, it is modules. It is blocks within modules. And each block and module had some very, very specific things that we wanted to do. We had a block which we called Core Principles, Module 1. We did this because it turns out we have a third of the students entering medical school today that are non-science majors. Come in and do a post-bac for a year and then go to medical school. We have people coming to medical school that have PhDs. They're different than a student who comes in who just was a biology major. So the first 4 months of medical school in the morning is really the core principles of learning the foundations of what is from a cell, all the way to tissues, all the way to organs, all the way to the body, all the way to what happens in the body with immunology. So you can move on to what we then think is important, which is this integrated systems and diseases in Module 2 starting in January, which is the way most textbooks are written that we use. If you pick up a textbook of internal medicine, it starts right back with, so what's the anatomy of the problem? If you're talking about someone who has congestive heart failure, what's the anatomy, what's the pathology, what's the histology, what's the embryology if it's an abnormal heart, what's the pathophysiology, et cetera, et cetera. And it all is put together the way you would do it as a person reading something, a story, so that you can link all of this together. And the concept was helping people link everything together. You do that in the mornings of the first year and a half of medical school, so it stops in January of your second year. And 2 days a week, you have integrated things with patients, with introduction to clinical medicine, with ultrasound, with communication skills, dealing with issues that relate to clinical things for the technology and practice of medicine, and then have this whole module also that runs that talks about communication. You enter your core clerkships in year two, January of year two, and it's in 4 3-month blocks. So we put peds and OB together. Thought it probably made some sense. We put neurology and psychiatry together. Thought that sort of made sense. Put surgery with emergency medicine. Put surgery with odo and opto and ENT and anesthesia. Thought that sort of made sense. And medicine went with family medicine. That sort of made sense. And you end up now leaving in January of your third year to enter what we call your electives, selectives, and everybody had to do at least a minimum of 3 years of a scholarly activity to leave medical school. That became implemented in 1997. We were the first school in the nation to put something like this in place. It had to be voted on by the faculty. Bill Kelly told me, I'm not sure it's going to happen. I said to him, neither am I. I have a faculty who believe they like it just the way it is. We are really transforming how education is going to be, but had done enough behind the scenes with people to say, think about whether the world is changing and do we want to just stay and believe we like it because it works, or we really want to move forward. They voted unanimously to move this forward, and it was implemented for the entering class of 1997. Now, based on the concepts the reasons why this changed, and you're going to see this today. Pre-1997 lectures. We all had lectures, note takers, et cetera. 1997 in this curriculum, all small group learning in teams. You do not have to go to lectures. The lectures are all put up online that you can get to 24/7 anytime you want it on all of your different kinds of modalities. Slides and microscopes. Interesting. My pathologist said everybody needs to look at a slide through a microscope. Otherwise, you can't possibly learn the pathology. And we said, well, you know, on these digital slides, you can put normal and abnormal side by side. It does let your brain see, ooh, look at that cell. Ooh, look at that cell. I can tell the difference. And there was a thing called a digital slide box that let you do that. The only way we got this to happen is I had to build cupboards in all of the rooms with the monocular microscopes that would be put into these cupboards. And I said to them, it's there for you. We're going to do this digitally. In 1997, we're going to do this digitally. If you think you need to take slides, and we had 35,000 slides for students, you take the microscope out of the cabinet and use it on slides. They never opened the cabinet once the digital slide box went up. Never opened the cabinet. You're going to see that the rooms all change, and you're seeing what when you walk around here for JMEC, for all the rooms, with a lot of innovative technology. Everything is transmitting information electronically. Textbooks, they don't buy a textbook. Students buy no textbooks. Everything is online, web-based information, e-books, et cetera. Do you buy textbooks?
No. Bought netters.
Netters, okay, because a classic, right? But do you don't buy textbooks, no. Library became obsolete. Now the library is a place where you get a cup of coffee, you go with somebody, and you work together collaboratively, which they never let you do before when we went to medical school, but now you can bring food into the library, which was critical. Coffee house setting, students wanting to work together. Learn at school? No. You want to learn 24/7 everywhere you are. Group study as opposed to individual study. And this question of, yes, you've been promoted for all your individual accomplishments and all those wonderful A's you got in college, et cetera. Now you're going to be promoted because you learned to work in a team together, to work together to make patient care better. So this is where we were when we went to medical school. Do you remember these tables? They were stuck into the floor. You couldn't even move them. Here were the microscopes. Here were the books. This was now the new virtual slide, and now it's based on these big screens that we now have. I was using 3.5 million sheets of paper a year to do syllabi. 50,000 slides, 166 microscopes, the libraries, lectures, and this is what happens. It's all on your iPad. Everybody gets an iPad with everything already preloaded. You can take it everywhere you go. That's all your books. It's all your lectures. It's all your syllabi. All right there. All your pretty. We didn't have it very good, guys. Okay, really, really interesting. And of course, group rooms. All these kinds of ways of learning, which is very, very different. And, just a very, very different way. So what we want you to do now for the next hour or so is you're going to sit back, you're going to relax, you're going to think about your questions that you have, and you're going to learn about how do we educate in the 21st century with three great people to tell you what we're doing differently. First, we're going to have Dr. Robert Doms, Bob Doms, Pathologist-in-Chief over at Children's, And he's going to tell you about the new pedagogy for what we've been doing since 1997 in a flipped classroom, but what he's been doing specifically electronically, and you're going to be participating in some of that. And then we're going to follow with Dr. Lipschitz, Gregg Lipschitz, who runs the Simulation Center, which is down in the old graduate hospital as well as over at the medical school. And you see our dummy here with our students, and they're going to show you how they learn simulation. And then you're going to hear from Denise Lamara, who's going to talk about standardized patients. How can we be sure that everybody gets to see the kinds of patients that we think they need to interact with, and we can tell them if they're either doing a good or not a good job so they do it right before they leave medical school. So, Bob, you are up.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. So we'll see if this technology works. So my slide should appear here, and something else should appear on the slides. So I direct the microbiology infectious disease course taught to our first years in October through December in Mod 1. And I'm joined this morning by six of our great first years. So we've got Nick, Ryan, Eric, Dan, Lauren, and Josh. And Ryan looks a little sleepy, but we think he'll make it through. I lead a department at CHOP, and I teach because teaching here is fun. We've got great students, and under Gail's leadership, we're constantly innovating with our curriculum. So I'm going to tell you about how we handle small groups. So in my course, for every 2 hours of lecture, there's 1 hour of small group. Other courses have a higher proportion of small groups. And for years, our small groups looked like this. So the students work in teams of six or seven, three teams per room. They get a picture, they get a clinical history, and a series of questions that they have to answer. Courses in medical schools throughout the country are exactly like this. And there's really nothing wrong with it, but if you think about it, this is a very linear format. Information is presented, a series of questions are asked, more information is presented, more questions. No decisions are being made here, right? Which is, of course, what you need to do when you see a patient. And it's largely memory recall. And so when I started revising this course about 5 years ago, I asked, well, how can we more closely simulate how you need to function in the clinics? How can we help students apply what they're learning in a more clinically directed way? And so it turns out in PowerPoint, there's this thing called a hyperlink function that allows you to go from a linear format to a branching format. And so what we have now, the students will have a clinical history and a picture, just like on the previous slide. But now instead of being asked a series of questions, they're given a series of options, like maybe they order a chest film, maybe a spinal tap. Some choices are good, some choices are bad. And of course, you know, some options lead to other options. You make this really elaborate branching pathway that ultimately leads down to another decision point, and the process occurs again. So typically in our course, the students have to select options that give them information. This drives them towards generating a differential diagnosis and ultimately a treatment plan. So, I'm really trying to do very early in the first year is try to simulate what they're doing in the clinics. They see a patient, and what do they do next? Not a bad question to ask, right? And so now our cases look like this. And so, you know, here's the case, here's some images, and here are these options. And some of these options are good. Some of them are terrible, and some are okay. And the learning teams talk amongst themselves. And I would have to say, since we put this format in place, the quality of their discussion has really evolved from, now what did I hear in lecture last week, to, you know, really trying to integrate their information to make informed decisions. And they click on these buttons, which take them to the next appropriate slide with additional information. And you can embed videos, you can embed audios, you can make image panels. And so, for example, here's an array of parasites, and the students can click on these images to reveal additional information about each parasite in any order they want, all right? This is what your clickers are for. So, for example, I might have something like this, and you guys can get your microphones and turn them on. So this organism is the leading cause of amoebic dysentery and causes classic flask-like lesions in the intestine. So what's the name of the organism? Which one is it? And what do you treat with? And so you guys have clickers. So one of these, now the students are not allowed to pick option number 10 because they've taken my course. You, however, may. So polling is open. Click whatever you think it is. So one of these causes amoebic dysentery. And you guys can talk amongst yourselves in the microphone if you want. So we have 12 responses in so far, 17, 19. Numbers are going up. and we'll show what you guys pick, and we'll see what the students have to say. All right, do you guys know what you think you want to do? Okay, go for it.
Hello, is it on? Great. So what do you guys think?
Excellent leadership, Eric.
All right, not Giardia.
No.
Okay, we got
to remember a sketchy micro video with Entamoeba histolytica and a flask. Okay. People drinking from a flask. So that reminds me of flask-like lesion.
Okay, cool.
I remember doing that yesterday
And the answer is Entamoeba histolytica. Now, which one is Entamoeba histolytica?
All right. How are we going to break these apart? Some are intracellular, some are not.
Well, I think it ingests red blood cells sometimes. So that would be one. But I don't know if that is.
You guys are picking one? Let's see what the alums have to
say.
I would vote for
one. All right, the alums are going for number two. Ooh. And number two is actually schistosoma. And what do you guys pick?
We pick one.
Ta-da! And so you can click these anywhere. So here's another one. Torches provide light, but torch is also an acronym for infectious agents that are leading causes of congenital malformations. So this organism is the T in torch. What is it, and what does it look like? All right, same process. So let me advance. Okay, the polling is open. So one of these images is the right answer. So click away. Oh, yeah, so this is the T in torch. So what's that organism, and what does it look like? All right, you got 10 responses. And you can just guess. You've got a 1 in 10 chance. Well, 1 in 9. 10 is always the wrong answer. So, all right, students, talk it through.
All right, T in torch.
So definitely.
Toxoplasma, yeah. Gandhi.
Yeah, if I saw a ring-enhancing lesion up here, I'd go right for it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. A ring-enhancing lesion would be too easy, so I could.
I completely forget what this looks like.
What if we.
It's not six. It's not six.
It's not six. It's not that big.
It's not, I don't think it's nine.
It's not four. It's definitely not four. That's.
That could be.
Is toxo intracellular?
The course ended in December, so this is a really excellent test of memory recall. They're an endocrine right now, by the way.
I would go three. Yeah.
You're going a three? Okay. The alums picked number six. The alums really like schistosomiasis. You guys picked plasmodium. That's a blood smear. Seven would be, that's the brain-eating amoeba. So we do this with Gram stains, we do this with chest films, and then you've got cases. So when you can read the clinical history.
A 26-month-old infant who is up to date on all vaccinations had been well until approximately 2 days before admission when clear rhinorrhea developed without fevers or other symptoms. On the morning of admission, the patient's mother noted increasing irritability and work of breathing, mild drowsiness, and a hoarse cry without fever, drooling, or inability to drink. In the afternoon, the child was transferred to CHOP. The mother showed you a video from her cell phone.
All right, so how would you describe this child's breathing? And that's for you guys to.
It's inspiratory. Is it a mix of virus?
It's
the seal. The seal sounds like a seal bark.
Well, yes. Let's do the symptom before we do the.
Yeah, so yeah, just.
The first question.
How would you describe
labor?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think this is stridor. Inspiratory stridor? Yeah.
All right, so this is an example of stridor, right? So creaking or grating noise, high-pitched breath sound resulting from turbulent airflow in or around the larynx, and can be caused by a lot of things. right? And so a narrowed airway. So now you got to pick an option. And the alums, you guys get to pick an option, 1 through 4, so 25% chance of success. Which option do you think would give you the most pertinent information here? And I've simplified this. In real life, one of them has a get more history, and I've trimmed this down. This child is up to date on their vaccines, by the way. And you guys can just start talking and pick which option you want.
Well, you want to see if like if he has like epiglottitis, yeah, then exactly. They can die like really quickly because then you have obstruction of the airway.
I feel like always physical exam is never a bad option.
That was a good comment, because the very first session, they always order spinal taps immediately. And then we teach them taking history is really not a bad idea. So, very good, Nick. You paid attention. All right, so you guys are going for a physical exam? All right, the alums are going for physical exam. With a fair number opting for the neck film. So we'll just click on physical exam. So you can read this. Just read it.
The child demonstrated severe inspiratory stridor with labored breathing, head bobbing, supraclavicular retractions, increased work of breathing, and possible tiring. The cry was hoarse. The temperature was 101.3. The pharynx was not exudative, and no foreign body was seen. The patient was taken urgently to the operating room for airway management.
And then I build in, oftentimes, review. So read this bit.
However, if you saw this on exam, what would be the leading bacterial cause? What would you treat with, and why would you treat?
That's for you guys to answer.
All right.
Oh, you want me to answer?
You know, well, no, okay. Whoever.
Is this Trump?
Whoops. Oops, I clicked accidentally.
So it's exudative, so we... No, it's in our case it's not, but in this case it is. Exudative?
Strep?
Which one?
You're worried about, like, long-term...
So there's post-colmate, but we can't treat for that, but then there's a fever.
Yeah.
All right, and what will you treat with? I know you love antibiotics.
Yeah. Okay, group A strep. What are we going to do?
Yeah. Was that penicillins, the cillins?
Very good. So group A strep, and you're treating to prevent post-streptococcal complications. And you know, a penicillin would be a good way to go with that. So we build in review stuff, and then they can click on go back to the decision point and pick another option. So now what would you pick?
The next one.
Yeah, I think we have to rule out Lego.
Which one?
We have to rule out Lego. Like maybe the kid swallowed something.
So which option would you? Which option would let you rule that out?
I would say a neck film.
Neck film. All right.
What do you guys think?
So neck film. All right. So here's the neck film, and on the right, the white arrows are pointing to the problem. And is this a case of whooping cough, epiglottitis, croup, or asthma attack? And the alums can vote. And this is the last audience participation thing. So you can see they click one option, which leads to other options, and sometimes leads to yet other options. These can be rather involved. You guys want to pick one? You have to pick one.
All right, so what's the steeple sign? Remind me.
It's the steeple sign. It's the narrowing of the airway that occurs in croup. And we don't see that.
Oh, you don't see that. Okay.
I don't think I see that. Need to work on my film review.
It didn't sound like whooping cough.
Yeah.
So,
and it's been like it's extended for, you know, it's been going on for, it's not just very acute, so probably not an asthma attack.
Yeah. It's
So say epiglottitis.
Epiglottitis. And so let's see what the alums have to say. Epiglottitis? Ah, correct answer. All right. And so then what I do here, we build in some, you know, additional information showing the thumb sign. And so, you know, they can read this information. And then if had they picked the other ones, like whooping cough, what I do, here's a slide from the lecture to remind them what whooping cough is. You know, we have another audio here. See, compare and contrast this to this particular patient, you know. So you can go back to this. You can pick, asthma attack. That was wrong, but we give them, even wrong choices have useful information. So there's audio built in here. You can hear an asthma attack. And then the final one was exactly croup. You guys right. It didn't sound like croup, which sounds like this, a barking sound. And so they got epiglottitis. And so the last thing for you guys to answer is, okay, you've got a child with epiglottitis, severe enough to require intubation. Cultures have been sent, but results aren't back yet because micro is slow. What would you prescribe? And there are a number of answers you could give to this, but you've got a child who's not doing well. You don't have a specimen ID, so give me an antibiotic regimen.
Treat you broadly, so empirically.
Yeah. We're treating empirically, right?
It's definitely a bacterial thing, though, like forgetting like the different.
Oh, you mean, yeah. I mean, it could be until you get. If it is, then you're gonna wanna treat empirically first, because
viral. Otherwise, we normally do supportive, right? Because it kind of finds its way out.
Into the microphone.
Sorry. Okay. So essentially what we were discussing is the idea of whether or not it's bacterial or viral. And the idea being that, to my understanding, if it's viral, what we do is mainly try to provide supportive care as it works itself out of the body, but we wouldn't want to miss the opportunity and do nothing in the case that it's bacterial, because then that could kill them before we get the cultures back. So we were contemplating our broad spectrum antibiotics, one of which vancomycin, and then we were thinking what else we wanted to put on there in order to make sure that whatever bacteria may be in the body we're covering.
Right, so vancomycin, anything else, or just vanco?
We don't want to cover any gram negatives, or do we want to?
We do. Yeah. So we're trying to remember what our.
Ceftriaxone.
Oh, ceftriaxone, yep. Okay.
Bingo. All right, that's what this is really good. So the concept here, you're treating empirically, broadly, you're going to cover your gram positives and gram negatives. So that's basically how this setup works. And then this leads to other things with culture results. In this particular case, the child was vaccinated, got H flu anyway, which allows me to build in links to the immunology course. So that is, and then at the end there's a summary, and then they can choose other cases to go to. And so I think five of our courses now have adapted this format, the students really like. Do you guys want to just say a word about just small groups, and then we're basically done?
Yeah, sure. One thing we can't really capture here is that we have small faculty-student ratio in the rooms, and a lot of the questions are, ask your instructor, and you have to elicit a history from your instructor. So in addition, what we see on the screen is one part of the actual experience of being in there, which is even more clinical thinking, I think.
Yeah.
And I think also just the fact that the slides with the wrong answer still have information, that makes it becomes less of a burden to like choose the wrong answer and be the wrong person in your group, because you're still getting useful things out of that wrong answer. And it makes, in general, it also just makes learning more fun. It's almost a little bit like being on a game show at the same time, as you feel like you're kind of in clinics, which I enjoy. So.
Yeah, we had a Jeopardy review this year, and that's where the competitive spirit of these students came. It's very impressive. Boy, I thought we had these nice students, and gee whiz, there was some really heroic buzzer hitting. All right, so that's it. Guys, thank you very much. Yes.
The students clearly had some information already in their own personal database. What type of things did they use to get that pieces that they had? All the right and wrong answers were all totally new information, I guess.
Yeah, so the small groups are really meant to reinforce it. We don't usually get that much new information in small groups. It's taking the information they've had in lecture and trying to get them to apply it in a more clinically oriented way. And, the information comes at them fast and furious, so we need to have planned redundancy throughout the course. So, they've had this stuff, they've heard about it, but they haven't really tried to apply it clinically yet. So I talked, they heard about H flu, the diseases it causes, now they're seeing a clinical presentation. So, it's a balance. So you don't have to challenge them, but it'd be no fun showing a bunch of stuff you've never heard of before. They would not like that. Yes?
The slides are amazing. Who designs and creates these slides?
I do. they take about 20 hours a pop to do one session. And But, you know, I think it took me 3 years to convert the entire course. And
he's doing other things as well.
Yeah. but it's worth it. Once you have it, you can do a lot of really creative things with it. I think our new generation of students, you know, they don't want to just sit and lecture all the time. And so, I make those. And our other course directors are doing the same thing right now. Yes?
What role does the facilitator in the school administration play? Do they answer questions if the students don't know it, or do the students have to look that up?
So the question is, what do the instructors do? This can be so self-contained, you don't need instructors. So what we do, we put in two things. We call touchdown points. You might select, I want more history. You click on it, but instead of giving the history, the instructor plays the role of the patient, so the students have to ask the right question. And then we also have cases that are called, what do you next? They just got a clinical history, and that's it. They talk amongst themselves, they come up with a plan, call the instructor over, and let's say they think they want to order a chest film. That's the right choice. The instructor then gives them the chest film that they interpret. So it becomes very interactive in an organized way.
Yeah, I think what strikes me is it's not only critical thinking and common sense. And I think that's more important.
The common sense pair gives you a very long way. So I would say it's kind of fun. You know, the first session, they almost all wanted to do the spinal tap or the program. and they weren't the first session. No, the patient's not expiring on yet. Give me history.
So at the end of the course, when you're undergoing assessment of how they perform, is that also the same kind of interactive process? And do they do that as a team or individually?
The exams are still short answer and multiple choice, though I come up with exam questions where you have some information and there are four options to give you additional information. You have to pick the right one, and then you have to answer it. But our technology doesn't support that yet for exams. So exams are still kind of old-fashioned, but most of the learning comes from, I think, the small groups of lectures.
But we do have team exams as well as individual exams.
Oh, right.
So some of our grade comes from a team-based format, which I think is really challenging, but also a really great experience. It puts this into a slightly different context.
Yeah.
Some schools have PBL, and this is taking PBL to a whole new level, problem-based learning,
yes,
such that it really is fun. So. Sir, we can't go back and do it again, guys.
I think you guys like this, right?
I mean, we should have a 9 to 7.
it's PBL taken to a new level, and we think we're the only school in the country doing this right now.
Biochemistry is now doing it. Our biochemistry.
Yes, biochem, genetics, GI. Gregg is converting pulmonary right now, but we don't think other schools have cottoned onto this. But we're gonna get out. Then we'll have to think of something else. Last question.
How stable are these groups, these small groups? Do people come in and out of them?
No, so once we're assigned, we stay with our teams for the full 18 months preclinical, and then we also sometimes come back with them, two teams that we put together to form a doctoring team, so that we can reflect on our clinical experiences and talk about what happened there. And I personally love that because I have heard about other models where maybe for biochemistry you have one group, but then you go, it's for genetics, and you have a different one. But the idea of kind of having your team, I personally think of mine like a family, having that support both inside and outside of the classroom, I've really found to be incredible. So, and it is nice that we often, as Dan mentioned, we start with our team exam on Sundays and then we go into our individual. So even, you know, you've been studying for a week, you maybe haven't been seeing people as often, then to go into the room and just to have your team there and to kind of center is a really great thing to have.
Yeah, I guess one part.
Who puts the teams together and how are they composed?
Can't be your friends. Can't have gone to school with them. It has to be half women and half men. If they're PhDs, the MD PhDs, they get divided up. The concept is to learn to work with people you've never worked before with, so that you learn that it's difficult. And usually we have 24 teams. When you divide the whole class up, then about six per team for about 150 students. Usually one team per 24 has a problem. And the problem usually is you've got type A personalities and type B personalities. The type A personalities want everything done the week before when you have a project. The type B personality does it 2 minutes before it's due. And there is crisis that happens. If the A's are going crazy and the B's say, leave me alone. You bring in a coach. You actually bring in a coach that comes in and sits and talks with them about, you've got to figure out a way to make this work. Because the first thing they want to do is put me on another team. That's the first thing that we're saying. And we say, that's not what life is like. You're on your team, and it isn't like, I don't like it, put me on another team. No, that's not what happens. So when you have a great team that works well together, it's beautiful. And they learn about each other, they learn their strengths, they learn their weaknesses. We take them away before they start medical school for 2 days to a retreat. We give them the Wharton MBA team training that they give all the Wharton MBA students, which has nothing to do with medicine and nothing to do with business. It has to do with giving them a task to do in a short period of time, like build something out of marshmallows and straws or solve a problem. And they learn about each other. This one, ooh, you're really a good math person. Ooh, you've got really good common sense for doing this, et cetera. And the goal is, on teams, is, you know, you're trying to make yourselves better than a single person each one, is that the team works better than just even six people because it's a cumulative effort that puts together all the strengths together. So, so we're the ones, and Wharton does the same thing. They don't let them pick who they're with. Either. Because you go on with your friend, you're not going to yell at your friend. You know, you're not going to tell your friend they didn't like what you did. But you might tell somebody on the team, I didn't like what you do. We didn't get that question right. But they didn't tell you when they do anatomy, they go around to the bodies where the anatomies have for the anatomy exam on the team exam, and there's a stick in something, and they have to identify what it is and how it operates or works. And only one person in the team goes to that particular question. So they are representing the entire team. That person gets it wrong. They all get it wrong. So if somebody comes out and now gets an 88 on the anatomy exam, and these are kids who have never gotten an 88 on anything, you've got a very unhappy team. So they learn to make sure, are you sure you know, because all the parts of the body, because if you get the leg and you don't know the leg, you're going to get it wrong. I get it wrong now, too. I don't like that. Do you like that when they get it? No one likes it. I like it when they get it wrong. So but this is all learning, you know, just sort of how it works.
So Gregg Lipschik is up next. So Gregg, I teach in Module 1. Gregg teaches in Module 2. And guys, thank you so much.
My kid ever had thyroid loss and shock.
I'll get started. We're just waiting for the two side monitors to come up, but I can start without that. So on your agenda, I think my name is Gregg Lipschik. I'm a pulmonary critical care physician. I have several roles here. But among other things, I'm one of the co-directors at the Penn Simulation Center, and I run the pulmonary course for the second year med students. On your agenda, I think it says... I'm talking about technology in the curriculum, and I'm actually going to restrict my comments to my little corner of technology, and that is simulation in medical education. You've heard about some of the other technological innovations in the curriculum. So at this point in this talk, I usually tell this story. In July of 1980, at Kings County Hospital in Brooklyn, New York, I saw my first LP. It was a Tuesday afternoon. My first spinal tap. The next day, Wednesday morning, I did my first LP. And 24 hours after that, it was a Thursday morning, I assisted with someone else's LP. I taught someone how to do an LP. Let me make this up. There we go. Okay. So for those of you who know this phrase, see one, do one, teach one, there's got to be a better way. And so that's what this talk is about. There is a better way. See one, do one, teach one, no more. And that better way is simulation in medical education. You've seen this before. It's from the Hippocratic corpus. First of all, do no harm. We were doing some harm for quite a long time. I found this archival footage of the attitude. Okay, I think you know what I'm saying here. But in 1999, this now infamous report, the Institute of Medicine's report on medical errors in U.S. hospitals, was published. It was subtitled "To Err is Human," and it made these observations: that healthcare was a decade or more behind other high-risk industries, and they specifically mentioned aerospace industry, in its attention to basic safety. It made this observation: that every year in U.S. hospitals, up to 100,000 patients were dying as a result of medical errors, and yet we never heard about it. And that was the equivalent of a jumbo jet crashing every day. If that happened, we would be hearing about it, and we didn't hear about these medical errors and related deaths. And they made some recommendations about systematic changes in healthcare practices and education in U.S. medical schools and hospitals, and they emphasized these two things: teamwork training, and you've already seen how we're beginning to address that, and the other was this innovation, simulation. Now, speaking of technological innovation, watch this. I worked on this for a while. I'm going to do it again because I liked it. Okay, so simulation was a way of reducing some of these errors through a variety of techniques. And let me just define medical simulation for you. It's an environment or technology in which the cognitive or physical skills of medical practice are acquired through the use of. And the list that follows that can be long and is growing and changing every day, but you can include things like audiovisual media, devices, mannequins, actors, you'll hear about that in a few minutes, simulated team activities. Computer simulations are now added to this list, and we'll talk about this a little bit. All right. So I just wanted to go through for you some of the types of simulations and simulators that are available and that are actually used here at Penn. First, these low-fidelity procedure trainers. So these are parts of bodies, typically, used to teach phlebotomy or IV insertion, central lines, central catheters. This is a knee used to teach intra-articular injections, a Foley catheter, and these are available, relatively cheap. Students and residents can learn on them, and they seem to work. They're fun. This is a family day at the simulation center where we put out a bunch of these task trainers, and the kids come over and learn to do it, and they enjoy it. These kind of things are fun to do, except maybe this kid. He's probably going to be a psychiatrist. All right. And then there are the somewhat higher fidelity and more expensive procedure trainings. Here's one that's used to teach GI fellows to do fiber optic endoscopy. We have the same thing or similar ones for bronchoscopy, the procedure that I do, and for other fiber optic procedures. And these are virtual reality trainers. The visuals are not bad, and they're actually improving. This is one from that GI trainer, and you get some idea. So these things, these task trainers and high-fidelity procedure trainers, do they work? Well, it turns out that they make the individual more confident. He thinks he's good at something. They lead to reduced error and improved speed in the procedure training. It's a safe, controlled setting. They can't hurt anybody. It's fun, so they like to do it, and they go back to doing it. And there's the opportunity for what's called deliberate practice. You can keep practicing until you're good at something. The question is, does simulator practice improve patient outcomes or safety? And the emerging answer to that is yes. It does seem to improve. Fewer complications, less anesthesia. In one case, it was shown that you can turn a novice bronchoscopist into a three-month bronchoscopist with just 20 of these virtual procedures. So this really does seem to work. So this is the real workhorse simulator, the high-fidelity human patient simulator. This is one right here in front. But just to give you an idea, these things can blink or speak or cry. They breathe. They have heart and lung sounds that we can vary. They can be programmed. We can have events or we can have random events occur. Many of them are wireless or portable, like this one right here. This one, in fact, can recognize drugs and doses. He has a little chip in his arm, and there's a little chip in the vial of medication. So if I give him dopamine, he knows that he's getting dopamine. And if I give him too much epinephrine, he knows that he's getting too much epinephrine. And he can respond accordingly or not accordingly. You can take these human patient simulators and put them in relatively common in-hospital, in-situ, we call it, settings, like an ED or an OR or a recovery room, and we can make stuff happen and have the teams that would normally take care of them actually respond and take care of them. You can add a little bit of reality, of realism to your simulations in a variety of ways with makeup or hairdos or helpers who are real people, and you'll hear a little bit about this in a moment. This is a recipe book that I found out online. It's not the one that we use, but it's a way that you can use common materials to make additional realism. So you can make sputum or wound drainage or cerebrospinal fluid. There's a recipe here for stool. Just to give you an idea, we use a combination of food thickener and Coca-Cola syrup to create real-looking vomit. And we use it all the time. It has the additional virtue of being delicious. So that I don't know what you're laughing at. But anyway, so once we're finished, we can eat it up. Okay. So, and then team training. You can take these human patient simulators, assemble your team, put them together to teach resuscitation or clinical emergencies. This is at the Children's Hospital. The simulator is a baby. The human patient simulator is a baby, and they're practicing a resuscitation of a child. And these kinds of exercises have been shown to improve communication, to improve performance, and most importantly, in recent studies, to actually improve outcomes. There have been mortality benefits for doing this kind of practice regularly, particularly in pediatric hospitals, but more recently in adult situations as well. We can also practice rare high-risk events with team training. So fire in the OR or smoke in the OR, something that doesn't happen too often. But if it does, you'd better be ready. And so the surgeons come down to the simulation center every month or 6 weeks with an anesthesiologist and a scrub nurse and the entire team. And while they're doing a simulated operation, fire breaks out or smoke breaks out, and they learn to deal with these things. There are also, so just to go on with the types of simulations, there are computer simulations now available. You can actually teach ACLS, Advanced Cardiac Life Support, almost completely on the computer, and then the students will come to us for a short skills check. But the cognitive part of it is almost totally now available on computer, and it works. I'm not sure it's the right thing to do for novice trainees, but once you know what you're doing, it's probably not a bad idea. I wanted to show this slide. This is actually Dr. Morrison's slide. It's a little old, and I should update it, but it makes the point that this kind of stuff is expensive. Standardized patients that you're going to hear about in a little while, we're paying them. What are we paying them now? $20. $20 an hour. My daughter does this. She made $20 an hour for 10 hours of work last year. She was very happy at it. Suture trainers, those very simple IV phlebotomy trainers can be a couple of $100, all the way up to the Da Vinci robot trainer. The actual Da Vinci robot machine is $15, $20 million, but the trainer is $1.5 to $2 million for a Da Vinci robot trainer. Simman here, the Layerdahl Simman that you see sitting there, $70,000 to $90,000 a piece for each one of those. We got a break because we traded in our old model, so I think they were only $60,000 for us. All right. So what's happened so far? There's been a dramatic increase since that Institute of Medicine report in creating and using simulators and simulation. A lot of specialties, including internal medicine, particularly surgery, who use this more than anyone else, and anesthesia, are now requiring simulation-based training of residents. The FDA requires simulation-based training of physicians using any new device. A lot of states and hospitals now require surgeons performing laparoscopic procedures to complete simulation-based training. And you can see why. This is something that really needs quite a bit of practice, the laparoscopic manipulations. Most med schools and nursing schools have or will have a simulation center. Many of them are sharing a simulation center. Again, this question comes up. Does simulation, it's very expensive, does it actually make individuals or teams better? Does it result in improved patient safety? And again, the emerging answer to most of these questions is yes. It really does seem to do exactly those things. I just wanted to talk a little bit about simulation at Penn. The simulation center was previously named Penn Med Simulation Center. It's now this it's now called Simulation at Penn Medicine. It's down on 18th and Lombard Street, the old graduate hospital, second floor. Their OR got converted into our simulation center. So it looks like a hospital. It has operating rooms and a labor and delivery room and a recovery room and a and we've turned some of the rooms into what look like hospital rooms or emergency department bays. There are also conference rooms and classrooms there. There's a little fake clinic, a little virtual clinic that's used for standardized patient exercises. It looks so much like a hospital. We make a little bit of money by renting ourselves out to M. Night Shyamalan rented us. The National Geographic Channel has rented us once or twice. So this is the venue for many of our simulation exercises. There's also a smaller simulation suite here at the medical school, about 800 square feet. It has a couple of sim men and some scenario training that, for the medicine and anesthesia and emergency clerkships is done there. So just to tell you a bit about what's actually in the curriculum, you're going to hear in a moment about standardized patients. These are actors acting as patients, not high tech, but very effective. They're used in interviewing and communication and physical diagnosis for psychiatry and for testing the students. In my course, I run the pulmonary course. I run the pulmonary course for the second year students. We use recorded sounds, a type of simulation, to teach lung sounds. Here is Dr. House with his stethoscope in backwards. Does everybody notice that? So here is the recording we use for, and that's a vesicular, a normal vesicular breath sound. Here's another one. Play that one again. So those are inspiratory crackles, end inspiratory crackles or rals. And finally, no, it's not whales. That's what the students always say. That is wheezing. So we're teaching in my course in pulmonary and in the cardiology course using these recorded lung sounds and sometimes embedded in PowerPoints like this, or sometimes we have a mannequin whose purpose is specifically to teach sounds. We teach now BLS, CPR, and advanced cardiac life support in a simulation-based environment down at the Sim Center. We make a little money doing it that way, and we provide that training for all our students. There are now simulation-based courses pre-clerkship. Before the students go on the wards for the first time, they have a little procedure course to learn some basic procedures. During the clerkship, we do, in medicine, we do scenario training, like an asthma attack or an acute MI, or during surgery, they have a whole day at the simulation center learning some basic procedures. Anesthesia, emergency, all do some simulation-based training during the clerkship. Pediatrics at CHOP has an internationally known group that teaches and innovates on simulation, and the students participate in those. And what's happening more recently is pre-internship, right before they graduate, they get a workshop, a capstone workshop on how to do just a review of some things in the curriculum and some procedure training so that they know what they're doing when they start their internship. And it's become an important and popular part of the fourth year curriculum. Surgeons use the simulation center quite a bit. They're down there 20 to 30 days a year. These are the surgical residents, and the med students who are on the surgical rotation follow them. So they'll do everything from basic skills like suturing this is actually an abdominal aortic aneurysm that we craft at the Sim Center, and then we have them resect it or repair it. This is not a real operation. This is an entire group of anesthesiologists and surgeons and med students down at the Sim Center faking it. And while it's happening, we can make things go on. Blood is spurting, alarms are going off, blood pressure is too high, blood pressure is too low, and they deal with those things. And finally, these mock codes or in situ simulations, putting SimMan in a bed, in a hospital, in an actual ICU bed, and stuff happens. and the teams are assembled and they deal with it. And in one study that we did at the VA hospital with this, we were able to show an increase in the number of clinical emergency calls, rapid response calls, and improvement in code survival, survival from codes, when we did this kind of thing, as well as the softer improved knowledge, improved confidence, improved communication skills, a little bit softer than an actual outcome improvement, but still a nice thing to show. One last little study I'll tell you about. I don't think Dr. Morrison likes me to talk about this, but I'm going to say it anyway. There is a Penn Botswana partnership sends med students and residents to a public hospital in Botswana in South Africa. This program almost died about 7 or 8 years ago when it turned out that the patients were 80% HIV positive, and the students, about 30% of the students and residents who we sent there, were getting needle stick injuries. And so the program was suspended, and we were asked at the SIM Center to develop a training program for them before they went. It turned out that the typical safety devices, ultrasound, for example, or safety needles or safety catheters, were not available in Botswana. And so what we were tasked with doing is teaching the students and the residents to do these procedures, LPs, IV insertion, et cetera, the way I learned to do it in the 1970s, that is, no ultrasound, no safety catheters, but using simulation and the older equipment. And here's an example of that course, now called the pre-travel procedure course. This student is doing a tap of the pleural space here, removing fluid from the pleural space. And using this simulation-based educational intervention, we were able to decrease needle stick injuries among med students and residents to zero. There has not been a needle stick injury in the last 7 years. So this stuff works. Okay. So this is my last slide. I'm not sure why I put it up, but I like it. And I do have a little demonstration here. And before I start my demonstration, I wanted to introduce two people to you. This is Kevin Williams. Kevin Williams is our patient for today. And pay no attention to that man behind the curtain in the back row there. That's Joe Durrance, our simulation technologist and computer whiz. I do need some help here. Are there any doctors among you? Would anybody, I need two or three helpers. You need no experience whatsoever. Come on up. Anybody? A cardiologist would be perfect. I need two more at least. A physician, come on up. Maybe one more. One more person, can somebody else join us? All right, great. So just to give you an idea, this is Kevin Williams. He is a SIM man. How are you? How are you doing, Mr. Williams?
You know, I'm having a little stomach pain chest pain.
Mr. Williams, I'm with the alumni. I'm shaking them down. I'm entertaining them. So I'll be with you in a few minutes. If you would like to, SimMan has normal heart and lung sounds right now, and you can actually listen to those. There you go. He's got a speaker there and speakers here, and he should have relatively normal heart and lung sounds. So that's, don't listen there, just over his chest. He should have normal bowel sounds as well.
Yeah, my heart is starting to race a little bit.
Okay, so now you can actually see his vital signs on the carts here. There's his heart rate is in the 80s, there's his oxygen saturation, his blood pressure, his pulmonary artery pressure, his end-tidal CO2, and you can imagine we can manipulate those any way we want. We could give him any rhythm we wanted to, we could increase his blood pressure, decrease his blood pressure. I want to show you just a few other things he can do. He has pulses. His radial pulses are not working well, but here's his groin pulse. If you put your finger there, he doesn't like it when I do this, but I don't mean
ticklish.
To tickle you, Mr. Williams, just... You can feel the pulse. You can draw blood from him. You can take his blood pressure. I'm going to ask you to trust me here. Stick your finger in his mouth. Stick your finger in his mouth. And what you should feel is trismus as his jaw clenches and lingual edema as his tongue swells, as if he were having an anaphylactic reaction. Okay, so you can let go now, Mr. Williams. Okay, try again. So again, trismus and lingual edema. You can let go now, Mr. Williams. Let go. Okay, you can take that. One interesting thing I was going to show you is he has pupillary reflexes. Watch this. His pupils actually contract with light. And he has both a direct and a consensual pupillary reflex.
My heart is really racing. I think you should take
a
look.
I'm sorry, Mr. Williams, what'd you say?
My heart is, my chest,
let me just finish with the alumni and we'll take care of you. You're a young man. This shouldn't be a problem for you. I really wouldn't worry about it. So among the other things, we can make him, and we do this with the med students on the medicine clerkship. Well, he'll have an asthma attack, or he'll have an MI, or we can do some trauma. He can have a GI bleed, many of those things. Whoa, look at that now. His heart rate's up to 109. He's having some PVCs. You think we should do
something?
You
gotta help me.
Should we do anything about this? Don't worry about it. He'll be okay. He'll be fine. I'm sure nothing's going to happen. But anyway, so Simen would get used, for example, for resuscitation training, both in situ in the hospital or at the Sim Center where we do our ACLS and BLS. All of those things are uses for Simen. The surgeons use him for trauma training. Whoa, that heart rate's really getting up there. He's 150, 160. We probably should. Let me just finish up. I think we're okay. So, just to give you, Does anybody, you know what that is? He's in V-fib. What should we do? What should we do? You're right. So we should shock him. Well, before we shock him, do you know CPR? Okay, I'm going to ask you to start CPR on him. Okay, we'll just go right ahead and do that. Okay, now do you know the rate? It changed in 2015. The guidelines changed. It's now 100 to 120. Now, how are we going to know that? There's a song. The Bee Gees' "Stayin' Alive" is the example.
You're just compressed to that rate. Nothing. I'm going to ask you to take care of his. For every 30 of his compressions, you get 2 breaths. You're going to defibrillate. So let me tell you, this is the actual defibrillator used at the University Hospital. It costs $7,000. Don't break it. All right, so we're going to turn it on. And now I'm going to charge it for you. It's actually charged. Yell clear to your friends here. Tell them to clear. Put one there. Put the other one there. And whenever you're ready, hit the button. Okay, did it work? Hey, he came back. He's back.
What happened?
Mr. Williams, are you all right?
I'm feeling a little better.
Notice that he's actually cyanotic here. He's got blue lips as his oxygen has dropped. That's another thing he can do. Mr. Williams, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm feeling a little better.
Mr. Williams? Well,
I'm feeling a little bit better. Thanks for saving my life.
Oh, okay. Listen, Mr. Williams, if you need to speak to an attorney for any reason, I'm Dr. Hattat, Dr. Brian Hattat. That's the name you want to use when you speak to the attorney.
Do you have a card?
All right. So we're going to stop the simulation right here, and I'm going to take some questions if anybody. I want to thank you guys for helping me out. Okay. Can we get a... And before we go on to the next talk, any questions for me or for Mr. Williams? So most hospitals now, you'll find one of these in an ICU or in an ED. They're very common in hospitals. It's not so common that there's a program to use them, but they're around and they're being used more and more. Yes.
They're reporting and they talk about near hits, not near misses. And so it's a different environment.
Yeah.
And we point to it, but nobody copies it. Makes no sense. The second thing is, three times in the past couple of years, I've been on an airline flight, and they announce over the PA, is there a doctor aboard? Well, I'm not sure, because I left the bedside a number of years ago, and I have, and this is a skill that you have to keep up. So they talk about maintenance of certificate, and we won't get into that nonsense, but here's maintenance certificate in real life. We all should have this. I couldn't find a course to bring myself up to date. I had to go to a local fire station and take a course with other people just so that I could try and keep the skill up. And I now carry this.
Yeah.
So that it's a device that goes on to protect you when...
it's a fair point, and we're actually offering courses now to community physicians.
There's something grossly missing here in the profession.
Yeah, that's a fair point.
Physicians should be able to get a refresher course no matter how long they've been away from the bedside.
Yeah.
And should be up to date. Otherwise, the
Penn Sim Center offers refresher courses for paramedics and nurses and physicians, and including retired physicians. They are available.
So here's the science, and we're not making full use of it.
Yep. Any other comments or questions? Yes.
I've read parts of that, The Average Human, and my question is, why didn't anybody write a follow-up book to say how long those people had to live if they didn't die in the hospital?
Mm, that's a good question, yeah.
They make it seem like it's tragic, but maybe those 98,000 would have been better off in hospice or palliative care.
Yeah, fair, but I think that the larger point there is the number of errors that were occurring, and could they be improved on? And I think what we've shown in the last 10 or 15 years is we have improved on it. Yeah. Anybody else? Okay, thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for hanging in there with us. I know we're approaching lunchtime. My name's Denise Lamara, and I'm the director of the Standardized Patient Program. And before I go into some detail about what exactly that means, we're going to quickly show you a scenario where I've asked our medical student, Chris DeFrancesco, an actual medical student, to have a conversation with Mrs. Williams, the patient who just underwent this procedure. His wife is waiting to speak to the doctor. And if you guys wouldn't mind.
Just for some background, can you all hear me? This is supposed to be a day or two later. And now Mr. Williams is in the ICU. Hi, good morning, Mrs. Williams. How are you?
Oh, fine, I guess. A little tired.
Has anybody come in to talk to you yet this morning?
No, I just got here a little bit ago. How is he?
Oh, well, he's stable. He's doing as expected right now. I just wanted to know if now was an okay time to talk about what's going on today and what happened yesterday and the day before.
Of course.
So as you know, your husband is a relatively young, healthy guy. Sounds like he came in through our emergency department, and he was having some kind of vague abdominal pain, maybe some heartburn, some indigestion, it seemed like. And it sounds like he was doing some work at home right before that.
Mm-hmm.
And he came to our emergency room, and our nurses saw him, and our doctors saw him, and they triaged him, thinking that he was a relatively low-risk case and that he could wait a little bit to be seen, because we had a lot of sick people in the emergency room that day. Now, in retrospect, we know that Mr. Williams was actually having a heart attack. And unfortunately, that progressed to the point that he had a cardiac arrest. His heart stopped. Now, luckily, we were able to start his heart back up really quickly and minimize any issues. But I did want to talk to you today and just let you know that we did review how things had gone in the emergency room, and we determined that we missed something and that he should have been seen earlier. And if he had been seen earlier, and intervened upon, things may have just gone a little bit differently.
What? Wait, you could have known something and done something differently, and you didn't.
So to be clear, we could not have stopped the heart attack. From knowing what happened, the heart attack was occurring when he came in. The issue here is that we may have been able to do something earlier and prevent the heart from stopping. But again, I just want to reiterate that he's doing well and he's stable now.
You may have. So you don't even know. I mean, what the hell happened?
So this is difficult. Our emergency department sees hundreds of people a day, from the brink of death all the way down to the common cold. So we have to have a system for treating the sickest people first. So when people come in, they're initially seen, and we try to decide, are they very sick, or are they not so sick, and can they wait? When we triaged your husband, we put him on the wrong end of that spectrum, which made him wait longer than he should have.
Give me a name.
I'm sorry, what?
A name. I want to know who dropped the ball.
Well, unfortunately, naming any one person is not going to help you. It's not going to help me. It's not going to help anyone. This is a team sport.
Oh, really. So there's a whole team of incompetent people then. Is that what you're saying?
I'm the attending here, and I'm here to tell you that as the head of the team, as the quarterback of this team, we made a mistake, and we are getting to the bottom of it. We're fixing it. And I want to assure you that Mr. Williams is getting the best of us in this hospital stay. And I'm here for you in whatever you need.
We could have used that attitude yesterday before the heart attack. So, what happens to his heart in the future? I know it was damaged in the heart attack.
Yes. So, when he has a heart attack, it just means that the muscle in the heart is not getting enough blood. And sometimes that muscle can fall asleep, sometimes it can die. Unfortunately, we usually don't know right off the bat how bad that is. I wish I had a crystal ball in this situation. I've seen this many times in the ICU, and your husband has some things going for him. He's young, he's relatively healthy, and that definitely plays in his favor. Right now, he's doing as well as he can be, and I have a positive outlook for him. But as I said, this, although it has a good chance of doing well, it could not go so well. And we're just going to keep an eye on him every day, every moment. I want you to know that I'm here, and I want you to keep track of all your questions to ask me along the way.
Okay.
And I also want to give you my business card. This has my cell phone number on it. Keep track of all your questions, write them down. And if you see me during the day, I'd love to answer them in person. But always feel free to call me at any time. We're going to take as good a care as we can of Mr. Williams. Do you want to go see him now?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, guys.
Let's see here. So Mrs. Williams is one of our standardized patients, or SPs as we call them. Standardized patients are essentially actors or lay people who are trained to portray patients, family members, team members, and any number of roles to train and test medical students and other healthcare professionals. Standardized patients have been used in medical education since the early 60s, and they've been used at Penn here since 1997. So one of the things about SPs, unlike role play, it's a measurable, reproducible methodology, meaning that it gives us hard data so that we can really use it as a reliable and valid teaching and assessment method. It is recognized by the ACGME, the LCME, and also, as someone mentioned, maintenance of certification entities are also recognizing it as a very important instrument. And I would disagree respectfully with Dr. Lipschik. They are very high fidelity, as you can see. So the other thing about SPs, in addition to giving faculty control over the content and complexity of cases for students to learn. For students, what SPs do is they provide a safe learning environment that's highly authentic And it also allows them to receive feedback from the patient's perspective on how they did interpersonally and with their communication skills. Now, I know we have physicians in the house. How many of you have received immediate feedback from one of your patients at the end of an encounter on how you did? Okay. Anybody have anything they want to share? How did that go?
In my experience, luckily, I've had most patients say, I'm so glad you were here today. You know, you really did a great job. I really connected with you. Thank you. I mean, that's been my typical experience.
That's wonderful. And one of our course directors always tells the students that she's a great doctor. We think she's great. She doesn't say that. But she said every once in a while there's a patient who just doesn't come back. You never see them again. You always kind of wonder what happened. So our standardized patients provide feedback to medical students in almost every encounter. So I think we have time for we're going to skip over that in the interest of time. But the SPs provide feedback to students based on the goals of the curriculum. So we definitely pay attention to things like disclosing an adverse event. What are the models? What are the best practices? So how well did the students hit those marks? And the SPs will give feedback in that way. SPs are used at Penn starting in the fall of the first year, as Dr. Morrison said, and throughout the entirety of their career at Penn for humanism and professionalism, but also in intro to clinical medicine for about 4 years. They learn history, taking, and basic physical exam procedures. Over the course of months, they practice with standardized patients before they get to practice with actual strangers. So it's a really important tool for them. SPs are also, let's see here. We started out for medical students primarily way back in 1997. This chart shows how we've been growing. The blue bars indicate programs for medical students, which are holding steady. The red bars are for health system collaboration. So this is graduate medical education, faculty development, nursing education, and other frontline staff. And the green bars are external programs. We do a lot of work with the schools of veterinary medicine, dental medicine, CHOP. We have regional partners as well as national partners. We do a good deal of work with the ACGME. So it's really been growing explosively, actually. The themes and specialties are endless. These are ours, and the applications are countless. Everything from breaking bad news, we do resident burnout, we do opioid prescribing, health literacy, genetic counseling, on and on, you can imagine. There's so many important studies that are emerging that show that a good rapport with the patient will result in better outcomes and also lower malpractice rates. SPs can be trained, as I said, not just as patients and family members, but also we're thinking about them as standardized professionals because they do so many other things. We've been doing a program with human resources in the health system. Every manager gets to work with standardized, challenging employees as part of a performance management course. We're also working with the Center for Social Innovation up in Boston for a national project where SPs are portraying at-risk clients for caseworkers for a homelessness reduction project. We're currently awaiting word on funding with our partners at the Graduate School of Education to train teachers and principals in training how to have difficult conversations that are culturally sensitive with parents, teachers, community members, and others. So it's really been growing a lot. Again, these are a partial and growing list of clients. We're in the middle there with the School of Medicine. Health system is one of our many clients, and it just continues to grow. And with to mark our 20th anniversary and in recognition of this growth, we're really starting to refer to our program as a hub for experiential learning and assessment. So This growth is owed to the creativity and versatility of our programming, but also the great talent of our standardized patients. This is kind of like the Last Supper picture of standardized patients. This is from our physical exam course last year. We have actually more than 170 SPs right now, which more than doubled since I started back in 2006, so 11 years ago. We're doing, again, growing at a rapid rate. It's very exciting, and we're going to finish with one more scenario just to demonstrate how SPs can do more than just be patients. So poor Mr. Williams, he's really having a rough time. He was in and out of the medical ICU. He's now in the cardiac ICU. And Chris is an extern in this scenario, and he's going to be speaking to one of the junior residents. This case was developed as part of our patient safety curriculum.
You called me, what's up?
Oh, hey, I know you're super busy. I've been trying to get a hold of you all night, though. Mr. Williams over in 10, his central line site's infected. We gotta get it out.
What? I'm too busy for this right now. I saw Williams before attending round started, and I'm not that impressed. He's looking fine. He's looking to be back on the floor tomorrow. How do you know it's infected?
Well, look, this guy's at super high risk. Since noon, he's spiked a temp. His white count's up. The nurse just grabbed me and brought me in to look at the site. It's all red. It's really nasty looking. If we don't do something, he could be septic on top of being in acute heart failure.
Look, there's a reason why she's a nurse and not a doctor. The site is just irritated, probably an allergic reaction to the catheter. You don't know that this is an infection. And right now, we have more urgent matters. I have a patient who's tanking in 12. I have someone who's in a coma, and I have an admission coming in an hour, so.
Look, I know you're really busy, but MICU policy is totally clear on this. If it's red, it's a bloodstream infection, it's a central line infection until further proven otherwise. Okay, we gotta do something about this, or else this guy could be tanking too.
Oh, look, don't be such an alarmist. His white blood count is trending down. I talked with his wife, Mrs. Williams, and she just wants him out of the ICU. His vitals are stable. It's just redness. There's no pus. If there's no pus, there's no line infection.
Look, I know you're running around. If you're too busy, I can go get the senior. It's not a big deal. This just needs to get done.
No, she doesn't need to be bothered with something this trivial. We have patients crashing. If you're so worried about your patient, why don't you remove the line? You've seen central lines before.
I've seen a couple.
Great, then you can do this. We're a teaching hospital. See one, do one, teach one. That's how I learn, right?
Look, I want to do surgery. Like, that would be great. I would love to change a central line. But the School of Medicine explicitly states that I am not allowed to do it. I sign a paper saying I'm not allowed to do it. Look.
You're such a stickler for the rules. I thought you wanted to be a doctor.
Like I said, I know you're super busy. I can go, what do you need? I'll put it at the bedside. We'll get it done quick. I'll even hold pressure afterwards so you can go do everything else.
Fine, I'll go and look at it myself when I'm done with this other patient. But I need you to grab me a cup of coffee.
So again, someone mentioned something about the airline industry, and that really is about speaking up to power. We know that a lot of medical errors occur because in teams, people feel intimidated by the attending physician. There's a lot of nuance there. So what we would do in that course, that was for our doctoring course, students were able to call time out, have a do-over, ask their preceptor or their peers, what can I say? The idea is to really equip students with tools so that when they get into these real-life situations, they know what they're doing and they have some sense of how to have these conversations. We do a lot of work with CHOP, where students have the task of having a conversation with parents of critically ill children about withdrawing support. I mean, really high-level things that you do not want them to practice for the first time in a real-life setting. And again, they get this very intense, robust training where they get feedback from the patient's perspective as well as from that of the expert faculty preceptors. So with that, I will end. If you have any questions, ideas, suggestions about collaborating, please drop me a line, lamara@upenn.edu. Thank you so much for your time and interest, and enjoy the rest of your visit.
Thank you. First, I want to thank Dr. Morrison, Dr. Lipschitz, Dr. Dom, and Denise Lamara for presenting to you today. Hopefully, you got a good sense of what medical students are going through today. It's ever-evolving, and we're trying to stay ahead of the curve here at the school. I wanted to leave you with one or two points of information. As you know, we've had a change of schedule with the picnic and parade. I want to make sure you all are informed. We've altered the shuttle times for this afternoon. We're actually ahead of schedule, which is a great thing. But we're going to be providing shuttles at 1:30 p.m. and 2:15 p.m. Directly outside of Smilo, and they'll do the circuit back to the hotels. Hope everybody enjoys the rest of the day and the festivities this evening. Thank you so much. Take care.